Well, I'm afraid I'm not really going to speak about, to talk about my precise research project, because I wanted to discuss a more broader issue that might be a good starting point for a dialogue that is going, that I hope will go on between all of us. Perfect. And so I want to answer that question, what do economists do? Maybe this is something that's mysterious to some of you. So my field of research is the history of economics. And I like to compare an historian of economics to an historian of art. An historian of art is not an artist. He's commenting what is going on in the art circuit. The same for an historian of economics. I'm not producing economics, economic theory. Like Raouf does, I am commenting what economists do. And so I have two possible audiences. The first one is economists, and this is my main audience. And so in economics nowadays, we are in an age of high specialization, so that economists, individual economists, are like food soldiers in a regiment. They don't know where the regiment started from and where it is heading toward. And so people like me help economists to understand the big picture about their general query. For a wider public, like you, the aim is to explain what academic economics really do because of the mysterious character of their work, and also because in many circles what we do is rather unpopular but also misunderstood. So the way in which I want to present to answer the question what economists do is to ask myself how and why economics emerged as a separate new discipline. And the hypothesis I'm going to defend in this respect, very briefly, of course, is that political economy arose as a discipline because in the 18th century, the economic situation had evolved in such a way that a new idea about the organization of the economy dawned in the mind of somebody called Adam Smith. The complexity of this question being so high that its resolution was warranted to mobilize a generation of economists, of scholars, to work on it. So there's a question that is so hard to solve that a new discipline was needed to address it. So it could be said that economics arose as a specific discipline because of the conundrum that it needed to address. Now, what is this conundrum? So Adam Smith, you certainly know the name, he wrote a fantastic book which is Moral, Theory of Moral Sentiments, which I recommend to all of you, which is, it's not economics, but it's quite interesting. And of course, his book, An Inquiry, the Nature and Causes of the Wealth of Nations. Well, Smith's new idea is that an economic system without any central authority, without a minister of economy, that is, in which everybody is free to pursue her own interest, is more efficient and creates more welfare, improving outcomes on all the layers of society than any economics that is governmentally regulated. This is a very, very counterintuitive view. Why is it so counterintuitive? Because we all are planning agents. We plan our behavior. Institutions are planning systems. IMERA is a planning system. Army is a planning system. Corporations are planning systems. Now, Smith's idea is to say that although planning system is governing all the institutions in a given society, as far as the global economy would be concerned, it would be better not to have planning. It would be better to agents acting freely, to the effect that, and that situation, instead of a priori, we would believe that this would lead to anarchy. And Adam Smith said no, because there are implicit rules that are not observable at first sight, but which he called the invisible end, and which is that competition and market forces would lead to such a positive income and would make this economy not only viable, but also superior to more centralized economies. So this is something that really needs a demonstration to be accepted by most of the people. And so that effort of demonstration, that view of discussing it or criticizing it, is basically what generated the rise of economics. Now, three factors were invoked by Smith in defense of this superiority. First, human nature. People are self-interested. They are prone to free riding. Second, governments, despite their possible goodwill, are bad at making economic decisions and even more bad at implementing them. The positive aspect is the fact that there is that, what I alluded to is that competition, something of a process that is not very popular, probably even among you, competition has unintended positive consequences. It drives the private direction of activities toward the satisfaction of social wants. To use Smith's metaphor, it acts as an invisible hand. Though there is a second towering figure, there is a second towering figure that we must talk about when speaking about classical political economy, and it's Karl Marx, the name is familiar to all of you. Well, to make a long story short, I would say that Marx was, well, you know all, he was a Hegelian leftist communist philosopher. And like all these communists, he believed that the relationship between capitalists and workers was one of exploitation. And so that was something that was obvious to all of them, looking at the very dire conditions that were prevailing at the time. But then there was an idea that dawned on Marx, also a big idea. And the idea was to say, would it not be interesting to try to demonstrate, to prove theoretically, to construct a theoretical body that to prove that intuition, that the relationship between capitalists and workers can be subsumed under the concept of exploitation. So he was a militant, he wrote the Manifesto of the Communist Party, he was a philosopher, but then he decided to address a question that can be considered as an economic question. So he was, well, so, and this implied, so Marx set himself that task, and so the first thing to do was to go and read the writings of political economics. Not only Adam Smith, but also Malthus, Ricardo, and the others. Marx was very well aware that these people were his political foe. They were defenders of laissez-faire, and they were defending capitalism, and he wanted to overthrow it. Nonetheless, he started reading them, and then, to his surprise, he realized that the conceptual apparatus built by his political economics was totally adequate to his own aim. Actually, they provide him an apparatus to which he had just to add a further step to draw some conclusions to arrive at its result. And so, demonstrating that the quantity labeled total profit in a capitalist economy would be nothing else than unpaid labor appropriated by capitalists. And so, he was able to turn upside down the conceptual apparatus, making it serve the purpose of defending his view about the extinction of capitalism and the development of communism. So a historian of economics like me, so a historian like me cannot but find these contributions of Smith, Ricardo, and Marx awesome, in the same way as historians of art are impressed by great paintings. We are in a great intellectual thinking. So it is really impressive. Unsurprisingly, both of their reasoning, although very brilliant, didn't stand up to scrutiny. What they had in common, however, is that they both use the same concept of l'apparatus centered on the notion of equilibrium. Economists are the only social sciences who have equilibrium at the center of their analysis. But there's also something else in common, which is that both their theoretical reasonings were underpinned by an ideological dimension. At stake is of the analysis is the dispute about the ideal organization of society in its economic dimension. On the one hand, Smith pursues the aim of extolling the virtues of capitalism, while Marx wants to condemn it. Now, I want to jump from 1860 to the 1960s. And there, what happens is a fantastic development of economics, a ramification. And this is a synthesis. I'm not going to describe all the points of the ramification, but it shows how complex economics has become. There are different schools, institutional economics, classical economics, Marxian, neoclassical game theory, and within them, different specializations, different subfields. So the economics is no longer as simple as it used to be. So what we need, it's not as simple, but so nonetheless, we should try to ask the question, are there emblematic figures in the 1960s which could be compared to Adam Smith and to Marx? And the answer is yes. These two people are also names that are probably familiar to you, Keynes and Milton Friedman. Here the divide is no longer between defenders of and opponents of capitalism. It opposes now people who are mitigated economist liberalism, meaning that they support the capitalist system, but that they admit that it's prone to malfunctioning and that it would be the role of the state to work on them. And on the other hand, full-blown laissez-faire economists like Milton Friedman, really the descendants of Hayek, really the descendants. I could have taken the name of Hayek, the real descendants of Adam Smith. But what we observed with respect to Smith and Marx is again true here. Economics of both sides use the same conceptual apparatus, now neoclassical theory, as the basis from which they draw different policy conclusions. Conclusion. One week ago, Virginia observed that all of us are musicians. Well, this motto is true for economics. All of us are engaged in political economy discussions at the dining table, at the terraces of cafe, in politics. We are all engaged in this type of discussion. However, there is a difference. Music is more innocuous than economics. La musique adoucit les mœurs, not economics. If economics, if the concern of economics is the ideal organization of society in its economic dimension, everybody has the right and the duty to engage in it. Still, it is sometimes frustrating for economists when they see people who talk about economics and the talk of which look to them pure rubbish talk, while they have devoted years and years to make some more rigorous analysis of the same type of objects. So this is what I wanted to tell you about, and say about my position, and this follows from my position in this assembly. I am one of the only economists in the assembly, and I like economics. I find it a fascinating discipline, but there are many misunderstandings about it. And one subject of our discussion might be discussing more in depth what I said very briefly. As far as my more narrow
project is concept, my project is concept, it is narrower. What I want to study is a an episode which is contemporary in economics, where there is a possible change, not in paradigm, but nonetheless an important transformation, which is the rise of new ways of doing economics, which are and which have an interdisciplinary component, since that this is namely behavioral economics. And what I want to do in my technical project that I'm going to present is to reflect on that dimension, but again with my background of an historian of economics. And so, and also my interest in concept, and so looking at the way whether what is solid in the concept of interdisciplinarity, or for example, whether the evolution economics are just borrowing from psychology, but at the end of the day, economists still remain economists, and psychologists still remain psychologists. So this is what I'm going to work on. But as I said, I wanted to take the opportunity of this first presentation to make this very bold and probably provocative.
Not provocative at all. Thank you very much.